Good afternoon, everyone. I hope everyone can hear me okay. Okay? Speak a little louder. Okay. I'm Stephen Price. I'm the Associate Director of Music and Organist here at First United Methodist Church. Just a little bit about me. I'm originally from Buffalo, New York. Okay. After finishing high school, I did my undergrad at Western Connecticut State University in Danbury, Connecticut for 4 years. After completing my bachelor's degree, I received a Fulbright grant to France, and I studied in France for 1 year in the city of Toulouse, which is in the south of France, and I studied organ at the conservatoire, and that was just for a year. Then I returned to the U.S. and started my master's degree at Indiana University in Bloomington, Indiana, and decided to stay after 2 years there and go on to the doctoral degree. And I'm currently finishing up the doctoral degree. I finished my coursework, so I have my exams to do and my dissertation to write. And so I've been here since July, and it's been really busy, and I've been really enjoying it, and it's so fun and creative, and I get to do things like this. So this concert is a birthday celebration, of course. We have our special lady here. And Lowell Mason is the theme of the concert. So I've chosen organ arrangements based on tunes by Lowell Mason. So just a bit of just history about Lowell Mason. So Dr. Lowell Mason is justly called the father of American church music, and by his laborers were founded the principles of national music, intelligence, and knowledge, which afforded a soil upon which all higher musical education has been founded. To him, we owe some of our best ideas in religious church music, elementary musical education, music in the schools, the popularization of music, chorus singing, and the art of teaching music upon teaching and community music. More than that, we owe him no small share of the respect which the profession of music enjoys at the present time, as contrasted with the contempt in which it was held a century or more ago. In fact, the entire art of music, as now understood and practiced in America, was derived from him. Lowell Mason was born in Massachusetts, January 8th, 1792. From childhood, he had manifested an intense love for music and had devoted all of his spare time and effort to improving himself according to such opportunities as were available to him. At the age of 20, he found himself filling a clerkship in the banking house in Savannah, Georgia. Here, he lost no opportunity of gratifying his passion for musical advancement and was fortunate to meet for the first time a thoroughly qualified instructor and a person of F.L. Abel. Applying his spare hours to the cultivation and pursuit to which his passion inclined him, he soon acquired a proficiency that enabled him to embody in the compilation of a collection of church music, which contained many of his own compositions. The manuscript was offered unavailingly to the publishers of Philadelphia and Boston. Fortunately for our musical advancement, it finally secured the attention of a Boston Handel and Haydn Society, and by its committee was submitted to the Dr. J. Key Jackson, the severest critic in Boston. Dr. Jackson approved most heartily of the work by Mason and had added a few of his own compositions to it. Thus enlarged, it was finally published in 1822 as the Handel and Haydn Society Collection of Church Music. Mason's name was omitted from the publication at his own request, which he thus explains, quote, "I was then a bank officer in Savannah and did not wish to be known as a musical man, as I had not the least thought of ever making music a profession," end quote. President Winchester of the Handel and Haydn Society sold the copyright for the young man, Mr. Mason, went back to Savannah with probably $500 in his pocket as a preliminary result of his Boston visit. The book soon sprang into universal popularity, being at once adopted by the singing schools of New England, and through this means entering into the church choirs to whom it opened up a higher field of harmonic beauty. its career of success ran through some 17 editions. On realizing this success, Mason determined to accept an invitation to come to Boston and enter as a member of the Handel and Haydn Society. He was given the invitation, but declined to accept this and entered the ranks as an active member on an honorary basis. He had been invited to come to Boston by President Winchester and other musical friends and was guaranteed an income of $2,000 a year as a part of serving on the society. He was also appointed by the influence of these friends, directors of music at Hanover, Green, and Park Street churches to alternate 6 months with each congregation. Finally, he made a permanent arrangement with the Bowden Street Church and gave up the guarantee, but again, friendly influences stepped him in and procured him the position of a teller at American Bank. So he went from banker to musician back to banker. In 1827, Lowell Mason became president and conductor of the Handel and Haydn Society. It was the beginning of a career that was to win for him, as had been already stated, the title of the father of church music. Although this may seem rather a bold claim, it is not too much under the circumstances. Mr. Mason might have been in the average ranks of musicianship had he had lived in Europe. In America, he was well in advance of his surroundings. It was not too high praise in spite of Mason's very simple style and character. When Dr. Jackson wrote his song collection, "It is much the best book I have been published, seen published in this country, and I do not hesitate to give it my most decided critique," or that the great contrapuntal and great musician Hauptmann should say the harmonies of the tunes were dignified and church-like, and that the counterpoint was good, plain, singable, and melodious. Charles C. Perkins gives a few of the reasons why Lowell Mason was the very man to lead American music as it then existed. He says, quote, "First and foremost, he was not so very much superior to the members as to be unreasonably impatient at their shortcomings. Second, he was a born teacher who, by hard work, had fitted himself to give instruction in singing. Third, he was one of themselves, a plain, self-made man who could understand them and be understood by them." The personality of Dr. Mason was of great use to the art and appreciation of music in this country. He was of strong mind, dignified manners, sensitive yet sweet and engaging. Professor Horace Mann, one of the greatest educators of that day, said he would walk 50 miles to see and hear Lowell Mason teach if he could not otherwise have that advantage. Dr. Mason visited a number of music schools in Europe, studied their methods, incorporated the best things in his own work from his study. He founded the Boston Academy of Music. The aim of this institution was to reach the masses and introduce music into public schools. Dr. Mason resided in Boston from 1826 to 1851. When he moved from Boston to New York after 1851. Not only Boston benefited directly by this enthusiastic teacher's instruction, but he was constantly traveling to other societies in distant cities and helping their work. He had notably comprised classes at North Reading, Massachusetts, and he went in his later years as far as Rochester, New York as well to work in schools there, where he trained a chorus of 500 voices, many of them teachers, and some of them coming long distance to study under him in Rochester. Before 1810, he had developed his idea of teachers' convention, and as in these, he had representatives from different states come to make musical contributions and give lectures. He left behind him no less than 50 volumes of musical collections, instruction books, and manuals. As a composer of solid, endearing church music, Dr. Mason was one of the most successful this country has ever known. He was a deeply poised man and was a communicator in just introducing music to the community. Dr. Mason, in 1817, married Miss Abigail Gregory of Leesboro, Massachusetts. The family consisted of four sons, Daniel Gregory, Lowell, William, and Henry. The two former founded the publishing house of Mason Brothers, William and Henry. And Lowell and Henry, the first two, were the founders of the great organ manufacturer of Mason and Hamlin. Dr. William Mason was one of the most eminent musicians that America has yet to had seen in that time or produce. Dr. Lowell Mason died at Silver Spring, a beautiful residence on the side of Orange Mountain, New Jersey, August 11, 1872. He left behind his great musical library, much of which has been collected abroad and also given to the Yale College. And this information and biography comes from the biographies of gospel song and hymn writers published in New York by the Fleming and Revell Company. So we will begin, if you look at your program, with Asmon, arranged by Hal Hompson. This tune is known as "O For a Thousand Tongues to Sing." This arrangement was made by Lowell Mason in 1839, but it was first originally written by a German composer, Carl G. Glasser, in 1828. But Mason took the arrangement and specifically set it for the tune. And just a little bit about the text, written by Charles Wesley. Charles Wesley was suffering from a disease in May 1738, while he and his brother were studying under the Moravian scholar, Peter Bohler, in London. At the time, Wesley was plagued by extreme doubts about his faith, taken to bed with the sickness on May 21st. Wesley was attended by a group of Christians who offered him testimony and basic care, and he was deeply affected by this. He read from his Bible and found himself deeply affected by the words and at peace with God. Shortly, his strength began to return. He wrote of this experience in his journal and counted it as a renewal of his faith. When his brother, John, had similar experiences later, the two men met and sang a hymn Wesley had written in praise of his renewal. And the text to that hymn was, "O For a Thousand Tongues to Sing." So this arrangement is basically set in variation form. Hobson basically starts with a big entrata on kind of full organ, and then he does variations of trumpet calls and two-part writing, and then there's a soft movement with strings and flutes of the organ, and then it ends with full organ.
Thank you.
So the next two tunes I would like to play as a set, Bethany and Olivet. So we'll start with Bethany, known as Nearer My God to Thee. The verse was written by English poet and Unitarian hymn writer Sarah Flower Adams. 1805 to 1848 is when she lived. And she lived in England. It was the first set to music by Adam's sister, the text, and composer Eliza Flower for William Johnson Fox's collection, Hymns and Anthems. It's known as one of the great 19th century Christian hymns by Sarah Flower Adams, based loosely on Genesis 28, 11 through 19, the story of Jacob's dream. Genesis, and it can be translated as follows. So he came to a certain place and stayed there all night because the sun had set. And he took one of the stones of that place and put it at his head. And he lay down in that place to sleep. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached to heaven. And there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Another event that this tune is associated with is the sinking of the Titanic. If you saw the movie, I guess that is something that's believed to be true. Before the ship went down, that was the last piece of music that people heard on the ship. So the next tune, For My Faith Looks Up to Thee, written in 1830 by Ray Palmer. Palmer, who wrote these lyrics upon receiving a vision of Christ shortly after his graduation from Yale University while working as a tutor at a New York school. However, he kept them to himself until meeting Lowell Mason on a street in Boston, Massachusetts. When Mason asked him to write something for a new hymnal, Palmer dug out his old notes and produced these lyrics, written from 2 years earlier. After taking the lyrics home and reading them, Mason composed the tune, To My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Several days later, he saw Palmer again and said, "You may live many years and do many good things, but I think you will be best known as an author to one of America's most loved hymns, My Faith Looks Up to Thee." So Bethany, the setting of Bethany, set by Seth Bingham. Seth Bingham was a famous organist in the early 20th century based in New York City and was a well-known church musician. And the second setting for My Faith Looks Up to Thee by Eleanor Wisette, a female composer in the church music world who has contributed and composed a lot of hymn arrangements and anthems. So I hope you enjoy these two pieces. Okay, so we come to the last two tunes. Hamburg, known as When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, and Antioch, Joy to the World. The hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, was written by Isaac Watts and published in Hymns and Spiritual Songs in 1707. It is significant for being an innovative departure from the early English hymn style of only using paraphrased biblical texts, although the first two lines of the second verse do paraphrase St. Paul's at Galatians 6:14. The poetry of When I Survey may be seen as English literary Baroque. The hymn's fourth verse, His Dying Crimson, is commonly omitted in printed versions, a practice that began with George Whitefield in 1757. Lowell Mason composed Hamburg, named after the German city, in 1824. The tune was published in 1825 edition of Mason's Handel and Haydn Society Collection of Church Music. Mason indicated that the tune was based on a chant in the first Gregorian tone. Antioch, known as Joy to the World. The words are by English hymn writer Isaac Watts, based on the second half of Psalm 98 in the Bible. The song was first published in 1719 in Watts' collection, The Psalms of David, imitated in the language of the New Testament and applied to the Christian state and worship. Watts wrote the words of Joy to the World as a hymn glorifying Christ's triumphant return at the end of the age, rather than a song celebrating his first coming. The nations are called to celebrate because God's faithfulness to the house of Israel has brought salvation to the world. The music's origins are unclear. The name Antioch is generally used for the tune. It is often attributed to first being written by George Friedrich Handel, 1685 to 1759 is when he lived in Germany, on the grounds of chant resemblance to the chorus in the oratorio by, as we know it, as a Messiah. Not least because a theme of the refrain from Joy to the World and Heaven and Nature Sing appears similarly to an orchestral opening and accompaniment of a recitative from Comfort Ye Your Heads and Glory to God from Messiah. However, there is no autographed score by Handel of this original tune being written out separately, and currently known documented evidence has come up suggesting that Handel actually wrote the tune originally. So Antioch remains at best a skillful collection of the borrowings from Handel. And these are sort of known as fuguing tunes, especially the bit in Joy to the World and Heaven and Nature Sings, and you have this kind of repeat by the men, and Heaven and Nature Sings, and then the men kind of repeat that. It's kind of known as fuguing tune from the day, which was actually originated from sort of secular bar songs. So the hymn tune is credited to Lowell Mason, who introduced it in America in 1836 as arranged from Handel. But in 1986, John Wilson showed that Joy to the World was first published in two English collections, one firmly dated 1833. Being 3 years earlier, this is thought to prevent Lowell Mason from being the composer. But his original attribution remains a likely root of often stated the link to Handel, and Mason was not shy or did not hide the fact that he also felt that Handel was really kind of the originator of the tune. As of the late 20th century, Joy to the World was the most published Christmas hymn in North America. So I'm going to improvise on When I Survey the Wondrous Cross and Joy to the World. And in my improvisation for Joy to the World, I'm going to include a quote from the Handel Messiah. So it'll be interesting to see if you catch it. And thank you for coming, and thank you for this wonderful opportunity, and happy birthday.